So in this video, I'm going to talk about Digimon World Data Squad, which is a PS2 game. The reason I picked, I didn't buy this game, don't worry. I only rented it on GameFly. And the reason I picked it to play it was I was a big fan of the TV show back in like junior high days. So I was always wondered what the Digimon games were like. You know, I've heard that the early Digimon games were a lot like Tomodachi, where you raise your own virtual pet and whatnot. But this Digimon game is just straight up typical RPG with random encounters and turn-based combat mechanics. It's a pretty basic game. There's a lot of interesting things going for it, but I think even a big fan of Digimon will get tired of this one pretty quickly, since the overall story is pretty basic. Some kids are kidnapped and you have to rescue them, and in the end fight the evil, powerful Digimon behind it all. And also because the mechanic at work can be quite frustrating. I was expecting more for the story, at least, because I loved Digimon up till, well, I only watched up to like season 3, I think. And I loved Digimon, and the story was really fascinating to me at the time. I don't remember. If I watched it again, it'll probably be corny and be like, I can't believe I like this shit. But the story was really good, and the game is really basic. You know, you just have one little cutscene that describes, oh, what you're going to do. It's not really a cutscene, it's a dialogue. Oh, this is happening, da da da. There's an evil, powerful Digimon. He might be here. You go to a level, you're in that level for, I don't know, an hour or 2 hours, you know, fighting random battles and leveling up. And you fight the boss battle of that level. And then you go back, and you have a little short cutscene. That's pretty much the story, the little dialogues that happen. And it's not very interesting at all. So that I wasn't expecting that. I was actually expecting a little better story presentation. But the thing that hurts this game the most is that it moves at such a slow pace. You move barely 3 steps and you're taken to a random encounter every time. It's just so annoying. I actually really love turn-based random encounters. But on this one, it even tested my patience, which is saying something. So you can buy overpriced items to reduce the amount of random encounters, but even that doesn't help that much. And the reason I like random encounters is because you can control random encounters. In games that have random encounters, you can buy items or you can win items that eliminate random encounters when you don't want them. You can't really do that in a game without random encounters. And you could also make it more frequent if you want to grind a bit. But in this game, you have an item that reduces the random encounter, but it doesn't really change that much. You still have way too many random encounters. Once you enter a battle, you know, once you enter, get a random encounter and you battle, the animations for every action, you know, you select an action, attack, or do a fireball blast or whatever, that's also really, really slow. There's also a bit of a waiting time between each move. So even a random encounter that requires only like 2 moves to kill the enemy can take like a minute because of the waiting time and the animations. With all the combat animations looking like some derivative, either smacking a guy or spitting out a fireball, the whole battle sequence can be quite boring. I just don't understand. Why am I waiting 40 seconds to watch him do this? You know, that's pretty much the game. The fact that you'll have to enter these battle sequences at least 30 times. I counted one level. I entered a random encounter 30 times for one level. And the level was just going here to there to there to there. So it was a very short level if you count out all the random encounters. They just lengthened the playtime by adding in all these random encounters. Oh man, you have to be really patient to play this game. Now the game does try to pull you in with interesting mechanics. When in battle, the Digimon in your party will have certain attack moves they'll be able to do, depending on their mood. So if they're happy or angry or they don't like you or whatever, and you can control their mood through like support items or support moves. A Digimon will have moves that they want to do depending on their mood. So the move that appears the most times when you select the character is what they want to do. So you'll have attack, you have like tail slash, tail slash, tail slash, tail slash. And then you have like 20 tail slash options, but you only have like 1 fire spit attack, like 2 fire spits. So the character wants to do tail spin, right? So you know what they want to do by how frequently it appears up. So maintaining good relationship with your Digimon by, treating it well, that's also very important. Not only because it determines what moves they'll do, but it also determines what kind of Digimon they will Digivolve into. And different Digimons can Digivolve into various things. Greymon, for example, I mean, Agumon, for example, can Digivolve into Greymon, right? But from Greymon, it can then Digivolve into, the well, I forgot what it was, but it's like Red Greymon, or into a Skull Greymon, or Metal Greymon, or Metal Greymon. There's different things that Greymon can Digivolve into depending on the mood, depending on the circumstances. That's pretty cool. It's an interesting mechanic. And these Digivolutions are the most important things to the game, and quite honestly, the only real cool parts of the game. There are lots of Digivolutions for each Digimon. There's at least like 40 for each Digimon that you get to add to your party, and to have them Digivolve into certain things, you have to make sure that your Digimon fits a certain criteria. These certain criteria being like, oh, this Digimon is a certain level. This Digimon, you spent this amount of money in the item shop. You walked this many steps, or this Digimon defeated this certain kind of other Digimons, and these different criteria enable you to for your Digimon to Digivolve into various different things. It opens up your options for Digivolution. But that said, the strategy involved in beating this game is just awful. There's lots of abbreviations to keep track of, such as, I'll give you some example. NSP, you have no idea what that is, right? NSP means Nightmare Digimons. WB means Wing Digimons. I don't know why they have all these abbreviations. So in order to keep track of what Digimons are weak to what Digimon, and what Digimons you have to beat in order to meet the criteria for achieving this Digivolution, you have to really get into all these abbreviations. Oh man, it's just really bad. And to do the most damage, you have to enchant your Digimon to have certain abbreviated characteristics that are strong against the type of Digimons that you're fighting against. For example, a BV enchant would be strong against NSP Digimons. Now, if this sounds a little way too complex, it really isn't, but overall, the whole thing is pretty much another case of rock, paper, and scissors, with the ability to transform a rock into scissors so you can beat paper. So that's what enchant does. You're transforming your Digimon type so that it can be strong against what it's fighting against. But with so many abbreviations to keep track of, and so much clutter of the user interface, it can indeed feel more complex than necessary. It doesn't feel accessible, and even when you come to understand the system, it certainly doesn't make the game any fun. The game has a cool Digivolution mechanic where you can just try tens of all kinds of Digimons, and there's 140 Digimon types in all if you read the box art. But even this gets tiresome after a while because some of the criteria for certain Digimons are just ridiculously hard to achieve. And those Digivolutions are really the only good things about the game. The game's pace is just terribly too slow, and the user interface is overly complex for no good reason. The storyline is really bland and pretty much non-existent. All there is, this guy is working now, has is different. Different cars signify like different sins, like greed, and somebody's taking the cars, and you have to take the cards back. And there's an evil Digimon behind it all, but there's also a person that's supporting this evil Digimon. That's the storyline, and it's just not very fun to get into. So, and the game is not all that long for an RPG. Even with the slow pace, you can beat this game in 10 hours. I beat it in 8 hours and 30 minutes, and really regretted that. Waste of time. So, and really, if the game was a bit more faster paced with its random encounters, if there were less random encounters, if there were less loading time, if the mechanics were worked better, I think you could actually finish this game in 3 hours. It's actually that short. It's just lengthened by ridiculousness. So, man, I knew that going in, this game was going to be horrible because it's a licensed game. But man, I had no idea what I was really getting into. So, that's really my opinion. I can't believe I actually got through playing the entire thing. I was patient enough to do that. But yeah, just be aware, if you play this game, which I'm sure you won't, that's what you're in for.